Good morning. And welcome to all of you. And there's not many of you today. It feels empty to me. We need to go out the streets and find your neighbors and help them come to church. But it's good that you're here. If you're here, we get the most important people here. You and me, and it'll be great. So welcome. In our service today, we're going to have Holy Communion. And everyone is welcome to participate in Holy Communion. And following the service, there are some treats. I noticed some cookies came in the door and coffee. And you are invited to stay in as some refreshments if you like. I'm going to be leaving as soon as worship is over because I'm going to Bethany in Loman. It's their annual meeting. I am so out of sync. I do the same thing every Sunday. I come here about 4 to 7. I drive to Loman. I come back, do worship here. And this Sunday, I didn't drive to Loman, and everything feels weird. But hopefully I can survive. Wherever you are on your faith journey, you are welcome here. As you find your way and seek God's call and direction in our lives. I'm going to ask if you stand for our opening hymn. It's called Here I Come, Lord, and it fits our service today about the call of God. Here I Come, Lord. Let's stand and sing our opening hymn.
Thank you. the Lord and giver of life.
Amen.
Let us come into the light of Christ, confessing our need for God's mercy. God of peace,
we confess that we are not at peace with others or with ourselves. We bring to you all that tears us apart, discord in our families, violence in our world, our own conflicted hearts. In your mercy, mend us. Reconnect us to one another and to you. Let peace reign over all the earth. Through the Prince of Peace, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
In the Word who has come to dwell with us, God has given us grace upon grace. Forgiveness that is stronger than our sins. Love that can heal every broken heart. Hear this word of God's pardon and peace. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, we are free from all our sins. Rise, shine, for our life has come.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of God's love.
That's me starting.
soul redeemer, for the countless blessings and benefits you give. May we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day praising you, with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, Samuel. And he said, here I am, and ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I do not call, lie down again. So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I do not call, my son, lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Then the Lord said to Samuel, see, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever. Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. He said, here I am. Eli said, what was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God be restored to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you. So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, it is the Lord, let him do what seems good to him. As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 139, responsibly. Lord, you have searched me out. O Lord, you have known me.
You know my sins and my present. You discern my thoughts from afar.
You trace my journeys and my resting places, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it all together.
You encompass me behind and before and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it.
For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your words are so wonderful, and I know it well.
My body will not give me. while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes see all my places, yet unfinished in the womb, all that I know are in your world. My gaze is my passion before they came to be.
How deep I find your thoughts, O God, how great is the sum of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. Count them all, my lifespan would be to be like yours.
Found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said to him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man," the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. And we're past the children's sermon this morning. The title of this first section of 1 Samuel, that first reading, could be voices and visions. What are the voices and visions that have shaped your life? Where have they come from? Has God had anything to do with them? I reckon there are a lot of surrounding and visions trying to shape us. A cacophony of sounds and collages of images tempting us, pulling us, pushing us. Styles and fads and what's in, peer pressure and family values and whatever is politically correct at the moment. For us gathered here in church, surely there is some awareness that we need the voice and vision of God to be a part, maybe even the essential part in constructing our identity. These things are addressed in today's lesson. It begins, "Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days." Visions were not widespread. What is that trying to tell us? The word rare. Visions rare. If so, what, pray tell, had been shaping them? For some reason that we are not exactly let in on, it seems God has become quiet, slipped away from the center, off to some corner near the edge. Things just continue to go the way they go, but not shaped by the voice or vision from God. But that is about to change. The boy Samuel is sleeping in the temple. And this word that has been rare in those days is about to become less rare. Samuel. Samuel. kid. We are told he does not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord has not been revealed to him. So off he goes to Eli, the man of God, who has, in this time of rare voices and visions, just kept things going the old way. Maybe there's a bit of judgment hinted toward him. When we read, he was old, and his eyesight had become so dim he could barely see. No visions here. And I'll bet his hearing wasn't much better. Samuel runs into the sleeping room of this old priest and asks what he wants. You know the story. You know how this is repeated until old, blind, and deaf Eli, unable to hear or see himself, the voice or vision of God, sends the boy back into the temple with these instructions to say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." This is a very good thing that Eli does. But we are told that all is not good with Eli. And in fact, when young Samuel says to the voice, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening," this is what he gets. "I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears it tingle." Interesting language. The voice is bad. "I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house. I am about to punish Eli's house forever. His sons have been blaspheming God, and he knew all about it, but did nothing to restrain them." Eli's house, this religious line, his standard and his pattern is done. Now you only need to know that Eli's sons, Hophni and Phinehas, could have been modern televangelists. To use perhaps unfair stereotype of the worst order, forgive me. They were literally using their heritage as the priest's sons to skim off the fat of the sacrifices. Literally, that's what they did. And as the priest's sons, using the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting as their personal little sexual playmates. The temple of God, the place of God, the lamp, God that had not yet gone up. The Ark of the Covenant in there was not a place of words and visions to hear and learn of the next step in God's unfolding plan, but a dead end of institutional corruption. Feathering the nest and maintaining the world view of those who pulled the strings. And Eli, there is no voice, no vision, and religion under Eli in the temple in Shiloh is just going on as a good old boy institution offered up as God's final answer, but far removed from the true will and holiness of God. But the voice comes again to a young boy named Samuel. You'd expect a child. You'd expect the old school to pull power, to intimidate, and battle, and belittle, and get the kid with the new voice of God in his ears to be humiliated into submission. The operating religion has a lot of influence. Even if it's been a long time since it's heard a word or seen a vision. And people
look much like giving up influence, their sacred way of looking at things, what's working for them. But there's a soft spot in my heart for old Eli. For despite all his shortcomings and all that he is about to lose, the old school religion tells the boy of newness what to do. Go back to your bed. And if he calls again, say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." Why does he do that? There is some memory, some remnant in him that still treasures that voice. And in an all too personal awareness of how awful it can become in your life, in your family, if that voice becomes silent. Your eyesight and hearing can fail to the point that God no longer provides anything to shape your life. And in the morning, when he hears from Samuel what the message was, all against him, you see some true faith still alive in him, though his own life had become so gummed up in other voices and other visions. But he says, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." I think of this text whenever I think of all the crises the church has faced and struggled through over all the centuries. I mean, accepting Gentiles in Bible times. What to do about slavery? The historical, critical method of studying scriptures. The ordination of women. Issues of sexuality and homosexuality. There have been many. Every one of them had once been absolutely clear. Clear and understood and enclosed in such a way there was no need even for reconsideration. All safe and secure in the authority of some Eli. All working very well for certain people whose beliefs gave them a sense of absolute privilege and absolute righteousness, beliefs that had been shaped and given them by convention and tradition. And then comes the vision. And the voice does not speak to Eli, but to Samuel. But it's here is where I have a fondness for Eli. For when he realizes that his authority is being called into question, he does not argue for the retention of his own power. He does not amount an attack in the name of orthodoxy. He does not rely on a set of beliefs concerning some past word from the Lord. Instead, out of a profound hope that God still speaks, he teaches Samuel how to listen. Voices and visions coming into our lives to shame us. They can be frightening, but they are also heartening. God will not remain silent forever. His word and will break through, and sometimes even those most invested in the old school will decide to no longer block God's vision, and will simply say to to those coming after. Listen. Learn to listen to that voice. You cannot do better than that. Say to the voice, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Amen. Well, if you would stand, our hymn is worthy, come and follow me.
Give companionship to the lonely and healing to the sick. Be near those they name in our hearts, especially Gladys Wolenschenko, Margaret Magnuson, and on our lips, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Fill our congregation with renewed zeal to love our neighbor as you love us. Open our mouths to invite friends and neighbors to come and see you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We bless you for revealing yourself in the saints. Bring us with them into the fullness of your glory. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Trusting your love and healing, O God, we commend to you all for whom we pray, knowing you will hear and answer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Your glory.
invite these to stand. Good and loving God, we rejoice in the birth of Jesus, who came among the poor to bring the riches of your grace. As you have blessed us with your gifts, let them be blessing for us. With the trees of the field and with all the earth and heaven, we shout for joy at the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. By the leaving of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Saying, this cup is a new covenant sealed with my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The table is ready, and all are welcome. You may be seated, and we will sing Lamb of God.
Thank you.
To invite those able, please to stand. Radiant God, with our eyes we have seen your salvation, and in this meal we have feasted on your grace. May your word take flesh in us, that we may be your holy people, revealing your glory made known to us, in Jesus Christ our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
May the word that Mary brought to birth carry you into new and abundant life.
Amen.
May the word that Joseph cradled in his arms enfold you with love and strength.
Amen.
May the word that angels proclaim in song bring harmony to our world.
Amen.
And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, will abide you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Our closing hymn, Lord, be glorified. Practicing the magic words. And you remember that? Well, let's pray.